Thank you to Akil for his wonderful presentation. My first question, Akil, would be, who can forgive sins other than God?
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa sallam. Who can forgive sins other than God? Only God can forgive sins, but God can authorize any of his servants to admit that their sins are forgiven. So for instance, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said that if you can guarantee me two things, I will guarantee you paradise. To take control of between your two jaws and between your two legs. If you can guarantee these two things, I will guarantee you paradise. How can a prophet or a man guarantee paradise? He can only do it because he's a prophet, he's given authorization from God. So a man can do that, a prophet, a messenger can do that, but every time he does that, it's only done with the authorization of God. He never does it on his own authority. And Jesus also forgave sins in the Bible, but he done it with the authority of God. So that's nothing new for any prophet to say, you can be forgiven or you're forgiven.
That's okay.
So this question...
No, he got five.
Oh, he has five questions.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Are angels allowed to worship man?
Bismillah. No, nothing is allowed to worship man. Only God is given worship. But God did honor man above the angels. And in the Quran, he says that he commanded the angels to bow down to Adam. But this is called, in Arabic, in the Quran, it's called sajdatul tashrif. It's a sajda of honoring the fact that man is above angels. See, angels don't have free will. They only do what Allah commanded. And this is why we don't believe that the devil is a fallen angel. The devil is from the jinn. Kana min al-jinn. The devil is from the jinn. He's not from the malaika. He's not an angel. No angel can fall. The angels are created and they only obey Allah and do what Allah commanded them to do. They can never disobey Allah at all. So this disqualifies the angel as being, the devil as being angel. But he was amongst them because of his status and worship. He was amongst them in presence, but he wasn't from their kind. But Allah commanded the angels to bow down to Adam. This bowing down wasn't worship. It's called sajdatu tashrif. It's honoring human beings because human beings can choose to worship God or not choose to worship God. So if we see something along those lines, it's not worship. It's honoring the fact that human beings are above angels in God's pure name.
In Isaiah 9:6, Jesus Christ is called the mighty God, Gibor El. In Isaiah 10:21, the God of Israel is called, or the God of Jacob is called the mighty God. And in Jeremiah 32:18, again, he's called the mighty God, the Yud-Heh-Vav-Heh, which in Hebrew is YHVH. Some people say Yahweh, some people say Jehovah. What do you say to Jesus Christ being given the name that the covenant God of Israel is given? And it's only used three times in the Old Testament, and he's been given the exact same name.
From what we understand of Jesus' name, his name is Jesus. It's a Greek. It's not even Jesus, but this is what we know him as. Isa, Yeshua, the Messiah. But the Messiah is the title. His name is Jesus, or Isa. Even in the Bible, it says that he will be called Emmanuel. Jesus, not one time in his whole life, was called Emmanuel. Not one time did anybody ever call him Emmanuel, other than what they say belongs to prophecy. So Pastor Taylor asked me questions that was in the Old Testament. This is not from Jesus. Jesus never said this about himself. This is an interpretation of what somebody's reading the Old Testament and saying apply to Jesus. Jesus didn't say this. Jesus never accepted this. Jesus didn't confirm any of this. The rich young ruler again came to him and said, O thou good master, O thou good teacher, what shall I do to enter eternal life? Why do you call me good? There is only one that is good, and that is God. That's contrary to the idea of him accepting as being called the Almighty God. He denied being God. He denied being called good. How much more of God? It's very close, G-O-O-D and G-O-D, but it's a difference. He denied being called good. We're going to turn around and call him God? This is not from Jesus. This is an interpretation of the Bible that they're putting upon Jesus and say, see, the Bible says, the Old Testament says, Jesus didn't say that. Jesus didn't confirm those verses. Jesus didn't quote those verses and say, did you see this verse talking about me? This Jesus didn't say that. This is interpretation from the Bible, and we reject that.
I'm not responding because I guess that's the format. Let's see. You said that basically implied several times that Jesus is not God, and he never said he was God. I explained to you earlier why that was. Even the revelation of the Son of God, he told him not to tell anybody. And I explained that several times as well. After the resurrection, Thomas clearly says, my Adonai and my Theos, my Lord and my God. And he accepts it clearly. It is a clear acknowledging that Jesus is his Lord and his God. I know that if, as a matter of fact, in Revelation 19, an angel, John is about to prostrate himself before an angel, and he says, see that you do it not, for I am just like you, and I bear the testimony of Jesus just like you. But when Jesus was called my Lord, this is personal, just like Rabbi is teacher and Rabboni is my teacher. Yeah, I'm just saying it's a definitive identification. You are my Lord and my God. What do you say about that?
Yeah, I don't. Okay. Very good. Thank you.
I say what Jesus said. When, after the alleged crucifixion, Mary Magdalene, who at first didn't recognize Jesus, and this is another subject, but very quickly, when Jesus appeared to some of the disciples after the alleged crucifixion, I said alleged because we don't believe in it, they didn't recognize him. She thought he was the gardener. You read the Bible, it says Mary Magdalene thought Jesus was the gardener. Why would she think Jesus was a gardener? Unless maybe he was disguising himself to be a gardener. Maybe he had a big hat on. I don't know. This is not for my opinion. I'm saying I don't know what would give her an impression that he was a gardener. But why would she recognize the man that she just spent years with? And she know him intimately. She know him. She was a companion and friend of Jesus. So when she seen him, she thought he was a gardener. Then he spoke to her, and then she recognized it was him. And she went to go hug him and embrace him. And he said, no. Don't touch me. Don't touch me. For I have not yet ascended to the Father. My Father and your Father. My God and your God. This is what Jesus said. He said, I have not yet ascended to my Father and your Father. My God and your God. Does that sound like a God to you? Does that sound like somebody accepting worship? Does that sound like someone that's trying to equate themselves or accept praise as being God? Or is that someone distinguishing himself from the Creator, from God? My Father and your Father. My God and your God. And he said, and go tell my disciples that you have seen me. And even after, Jesus never went back in town. He always told the disciples to meet me over here off the curb. If Jesus conquered death, why didn't he go back in town and show everybody, you tried to kill me or you did kill me, I raised and now I'm back. Never.
This is the final question. Okay. if a being, let me just read it. Let the word speak. In the book of Revelation, I'm just going to read and I'm just going to ask you to explain it. Verse 3, Revelation chapter 5, and no man in heaven, nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to look upon, to be able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much because no man, again, was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. In this chapter, I'm just going to skip down to the bottom, verses 12 and 13, saying with a loud voice to Jesus, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth and such as are in the sea and all that are in them heard us saying, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever." You can answer.
We want to give you a full opportunity to ask the question that you wish to ask.
Just
explain why he's receiving worship from every creature everywhere. And you said you can only see that he's human. That basically.
So your question is that how is God?
Saying he's only human, but all creation is worshiping.
Okay. That's right.
Okay, Bismillah. Again, what I see is, first Revelation is reading. It's basically a book of dreams that's talking about things that occurred. He's seen in a dream. The author, who believes, is called John of Patmos. He wrote a book called Revelations, and it's a lot of he had dreams. We find in Jesus' life, he refuted people who came close to worshiping him. And then we may find other places in the Bible where it says that people worship him. But Jesus himself, we're talking about Jesus himself. He never ever, from his tongue, ever said, "I'm God." He never ever, from his tongue, said, "Worship me." This is from Jesus himself. He never did this. Rather, he refuted people who came close to doing that. And again, the rich young ruler, "O thou good master, O thou good teacher, what shall I do to enter into eternal life?" He's asking about how to get to heaven. Before he explains that to him, he asks him, "Why do you call me good?" Let's not get this confused. Why are you calling me good? There is only one that is good, and that is God. This is from Jesus' tongue. So to quote John of Patmos in Revelations, that the creation, praising him, I don't have an answer for that other than Jesus refuted that. But if we look at it from the position of Jesus having the position he had as a great messenger, then we don't say that they're praising him as they praise or worship God, but they are recognizing his status and what he's done for humanity, and guiding people. Primarily the children of Israel, and guiding these people back to God's path, being there as a sign. So they're recognizing that. They're recognizing that. But they're not worshiping him as a God.
So should I keep it or?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. The first question. And I hinted at this in the earlier discussion. Is there a single verse in the entire Bible that states that Adam ever asked God for forgiveness, repented for his sin, and that God ever forgave Adam?
I can't tell. When you study Genesis thoroughly, you find that God warned Adam. The day that he ate thereof, he would surely die. At that point, something happened in Adam's heart. And God called him. He said, Adam, where are you? And he said, I was afraid because I was naked and I hid myself. What he did after that was he and the woman went and got fig leaves and covered themselves. But God did something dynamic that proved my point earlier about the remission of sins. He went and killed an animal, made a coat of skins, and took off the fig leaf and put on them the covering, which was bought and wrought through blood. It's the first dynamic manifestation of the shedding of blood dealing with sin, the very first one. Then in the garden later, he prophesied that the seed of a woman will bruise the head of Satan, and Satan's head would bruise his heel. The devil is a fallen angel, and he was right there in the garden. And maybe I wasn't supposed to answer that one, so please forgive me for that. I didn't mean to dishonor the process.
Inshallah, next time we try to make sure we get two mics so we can make a little faster. We won't have to inconvenience. Pastor Taylor, if the belief amongst Christians is that every sin must be punished some way, somehow, then how can it ever be possible for God to forgive without having to punish the person or the sin? Can God forgive outright without having to do any blood sacrifice or killing anyone? Can God simply forgive?
I do believe that there is a very, very, very small precedent for God forgiving without atonement. That's called mercy. He said, I will have mercy upon whom I will have mercy, and I will harden upon whom I will harden. But the pattern for 1,500 years in Israel was that God made atonement for sins with blood. And Jesus was the Lamb of God personified as Moses, and not only Moses, I'm sorry, Moses is called as the prophet, but Aaron. God so wanted to deal with sin with blood that he called Aaron the high priest and dedicated everybody, that word in the Greek and the Hebrew was Kohen. Everybody in Aaron's family would be priests, and they would offer sacrifices for the Lord. That's one of the functions of the priest, to offer sacrifices for the Lord. Then he took one whole tribe, the tribe of Levi, out of 12, and dedicated their whole lives to ministering in the tabernacle, to administer or to support the sacrificial system, the blood sacrifice system. And that wasn't thrown down, which is very powerful, until Jesus Christ died. Then the temple came down in 70 AD. Up until that point, they were still doing sacrifices. Well, actually, around Jesus, they was the turn of the corner where the rabbinical system actually began to take over. But there was a regression of the priesthood and a rising up of the rabbinical. And the temple was torn down. So guess what? No more sacrifices. God can forgive without sacrifice, but the pattern has always been sacrifice. And God again did this in the garden. That's because he's a just judge. If I kill somebody, I can walk up to a guy and he's very merciful. He's a judge. But he's still got to penalize me because the law has been broken. And so we lean on God's mercy, but surely, especially as Muslims, you know that, you know, there can be consequence for sin. It's not that God can't, but God does judge sin. And so I wanted to be fair and say there are times, but the system was in place for a reason. And if I can finish this, Abraham is getting ready to slay his son. Just as he's getting ready to take Isaac's life, he sees a ram, a lamb caught in the thicket. That's a type of Jesus Christ. And he said, you know what, sacrifice that instead, and don't sacrifice your son. It was the lamb prophetically speaks of Jesus Christ as a substitute, one who takes the punishment for us. That theme's all throughout scriptures. And we don't have time to talk about it, but I hope I answered it.
We have the same like the response for and maybe next time. No, I'm not too with the time. Maybe next time in our oversight, we should allow maybe at least 1 minute rebuttal, just to be fair to the other side. So forgive us for the oversight, because I wouldn't rebut, but the format doesn't allow. So I don't know, same thing for you. So all right, next question, Pastor Taylor. If the acclaimed resurrection was in fact a conquering of death, then why did Jesus still avoid going into town and being seen? If the acclaimed resurrection, Jesus resurrected from the crucifixion, was in fact a conquering of death, then why did Jesus still avoid going into town and being seen? It appears that he still was hiding. They didn't recognize him. Some of the disciples didn't recognize him. They thought they'd seen the ghost. It seemed that, you know, he still was running and trying to avoid the generality of people. Meet me over here. Don't go into town. If he conquered death, why is he still avoiding the authorities, the powers that be?
First of all, Jesus appeared on several accounts with different people, and at one time, in one place, to over 500 as a witness of the resurrection. On the road to Emmaus, they didn't recognize him. That's because he was in a glorified state, same as he was in when he took Peter, James, and John apart up into a high place, and he was transfigured before him. The description of Jesus in Revelation chapter 1 in a glorified state is head white as head and hair white as wool, feet as brass, eyes as a flame fire. When he's in the glory, he looks nothing like Jesus of Nazareth. That's one of the reasons why we needed the prophetic insight of the Apostle John to understand heavenly things as well as earthly things. And so the Bible says in Corinthians, to be spiritually minded is life and peace, but to be carnally minded is death. And I'm gonna leave it at that, but that's my answer.
Is Jesus God only when in heaven, or also is he God on earth too? And if he's God on earth also, according to the Christian belief, then what affects him does it also affect God?
I think our understanding of God is very important. You remember how in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God said, let us make man in our image and after our likeness. That word in the Hebrew is Elohim, which means God's. When it's translated El, it means God, singular. Elohim is God's plural. When Adam and Eve ate from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, another plural statement was made, and man has become as one of us to know the difference between good and evil. So, going back to Philippians chapter 6, chapter 2, verse 6, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon himself the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. He is reduced. He is a man because he has to legally and judicially redeem mankind from their sin. I wish we had time to go into the whole idea of sin and death, because the end of each of the first three gospels deals with the crucifixion specifically, which you say did not happen. And I know the gospels of the Injil, the Quran says that the gospels, I mean, Jesus is talking. He the one that died. He gave up the ghost. But for sure, Jesus is God in the earth because he has the seed of divinity in him. But it is wrapped up in flesh. It's described in John 1:14, and God was manifest in the flesh, the word was manifest in the flesh. And 1 Timothy 3:16, very powerful. Greatest the mystery of godliness, how God, and without controversy, without controversy, greatest the mystery of godliness, 1 Timothy 3:16, God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, believed on in the world, and received up in the glory. So he was still God, and he took upon himself flesh to die for us, but that's my answer.
If salvation is dependent upon understanding that Jesus is God, then why is it so vague that even Jesus said don't tell anyone. Like when he asked him about, who do you think I am? They said, what do people think I am? They mentioned prophets and Elijah. And then he said, well, what about you? Who do you think I am? You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. But don't tell no one. If salvation is dependent upon this understanding and believing that Jesus is the Son of God and God, why is it so vague coming from Jesus, and why is Jesus telling people, don't tell no one? If my life depends upon it, why is this a secret? And why is it so confusing and hard to understand?
First of all, Jesus is the Son of Man, the Son of God, the Son of David. In Matthew chapter 1, the genealogy starts off as the Son of Abraham. And I think there's a 42 generations from Abraham to Joseph. He's got a lot of son titles, you know. But the thing is that he's a whole lot more than a prophet. You don't have to believe that Jesus is God to be saved. You only have to believe that Jesus is the Messiah to be saved. The initial revelation was that he was the Christ. Then with the next statement, the Son of the living God. So the Christ means the anointed one of the Messiah. He died for your sins. That's the important part of defining the Messiah. The revelation of him being God was a progressive revelation that came on him, because he did tell people not to tell anybody, first of all, because imagine trying to wrap your mind around Joseph the carpenter's son being God. It basically would have went out with this man blasphemed, and that's just what they did. When he forgave sins, I think it was in Matthew 22, I could be wrong, they said this man blasphemes, for who can forgive sins but God? He said something very powerful after that. He said, which is easier, to say that thy sins be forgiven thee, or take up your bed and walk? But so that you might know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins, he spoke to the man and said, get up and walk. And immediately he got up. He was saying, both my ability to witness, to heal any sickness and disease, and my ability to forgive sins testifies to who I am. So he, even John, after saying, behold the Lamb of God, begin to doubt. But then he sent his disciples and said, this is John the Baptist, and said, are you the one, or should we look for another? He said, tell John, listen, the works that I do in my Father's name, they speak for me. Consider the very works. So there's a reason for everything. And I would say, if you study John chapter 10, you'll find something out about why Jesus used the term. Does not the scripture say in Psalms, you are gods? And it's because he understood that he had to come down to their level. And we could get into that more. But
you can continue this week in 5 minutes of the final summary.
Okay, well, I'll just go into that. Okay. Well, first of all, I just want to thank everybody for your heart. I just thank you for your love. I love you. Everything that's shared today, we share because we've been in the faith, right? You've been in the Islamic faith for a time. I've been a believer for a time. My walk with God began 26 years ago through an encounter with Jesus Christ. When I was 37, I had a visible encounter with Jesus Christ, much like the Apostle Paul in Acts chapter 9. I know that sounds incredible, but it happens. I wasn't looking for it. I was in the most broken place of my life. He came into my living room. And he said these words to me. He said, I have to heal this part of your heart now, or you won't be able to go any further in me. My wife and I were going through some things. I was pastoring, and I flew to California to spend 2 weeks with my dad. And while there, every time I looked at my dad, I broke into tears. I mean, deep, 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 deep tears. And I didn't get it, because I had a problem with that since he left at 7. I mean, by the time I was 15, I was over him. But at this point, I was broken. I mean, like, it was deep. And so I'm driving myself back to the airport. I know that I hurry up. And it's in his car, and he's in the driver's seat. I'm having to drive like this. And when I get out, I break in front of everybody. A couple hundred people at LAX. I'm bawling. And my father grabs me, and he says, I'll never do this to another child as long as I live. My life has been full of direct encounters with Jesus. If you burn every Bible in the world, it'll strengthen my faith. Jesus said, by this shall you know, shall all men know that you're my disciples because you have loved one another. We can disciple by love without one scripture. Just going to be real with you. It transforms. I'm here just to talk about who Jesus is and why he came. We didn't have a whole lot of time today. We could have gotten more explicit about that. But my witness to you this last 5 minutes is that he is real. I want to ask you to try him for yourself without any insult to Islam. But I'm a man of God. I'm a pastor. And I'll tell you, he's real. He's real. I'll tell you, he's alive. I'll tell you, he's the Son of God. And I'll tell you, yes, he is God. He's exalted. And Revelation 5 is the reason why the angel said two times, there's no man found in heaven. And again, no man found in heaven. That's because they don't recognize him as a man anymore. Because he's restored to the former glory. That prayer in John 17:5, Father, restore thou me to the glory I had with thee from before the world was, has manifested. Now he's the Lamb that stands in the midst of the throne of God. And even the 24 elders fall down and worship the Lamb. They bless the Lamb. In Revelation 22, and if I have even 1 minute, I'll just read the last chapter of Revelation 22. Oh, hallelujah. He says, he that is unjust, in verse 11, let him be just, unjust still. And he which is filthy, let him be filthy still. And he that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. You know why? Because at this point, there is no coming in. This is when the door closes. The new Jerusalem comes out of heaven and the kingdom is established on earth. There's a time frame for getting into the kingdom of God. There's a time frame for being saved. It's like a subway in New York. When the doors open, you gotta rush in. But when the doors close, that's it. Jesus said in John 10, I am the door, hallelujah, the sheepfold. Anybody going in and out will find good pasture. And without insult to Islam, he said one more thing in John chapter 10. He said, I am the door. If any man climbs up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. The truth is that if Jesus is this God that is revealed throughout the scriptures, surely he came in the form of a man because he had to die with all the temptations that men have. But if he is this God, we need to recognize that. But if you're only at the place of recognizing him as Messiah, the one who shed his blood for you, you can be saved without the works of the law. God gave Israel a tabernacle system. He gave them the law on tablets of stone, but it was prophesied, I'm gonna take my law off the stone and put them on the tables of your heart, because law doesn't work with sinful nature. And there's nobody in here since you started following Islam, or me since I started following Jesus Christ, that has not sinned. We needed a Savior and a Redeemer. How long do I have left? We need a Savior. God bless you. Thank you for listening. I love you all. I love Brother Akil. I thank him for his heart.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalam, wassalamu alaikum. I'm in closing, first and foremost, thank you so much, Pastor Teller. Thank you for the word, thank you for coming, and thank you for this initiative. We truly appreciate your time and coming. We hope to have more encounters and to cover more topics and get further into these subjects. In closing remarks, what I try to present tonight was who Jesus is, based on evidence from the Bible scripture as well as from the Quran scripture. So we look at Jesus as a man, and we establish, in fact, Jesus was a man from his own testimony, from the Bible, from the Quran. We look at Jesus as a prophet, and we establish the fact that Jesus was a prophet from his own testimony, from the Bible, as well as the Quran. We look at Jesus as a Messiah, and we establish the fact that Jesus was a Messiah from the Bible and from the Quran. We looked at Jesus as the Son of God. We established the fact from Jesus being the Son of God from the Bible, but not from the Quran. And we looked at the idea of Son of God not being a particular Son of God, because God had many sons in the Bible. And we explained that the Son of God means a righteous person, one that was devout to God. This is a very common Jewish idiom. Then we looked at the idea of Jesus being a God. Was Jesus a God? And I don't believe that we established that at all.
neither from the Bible nor from the Quran. So this is what we looked at in terms of Jesus, who he was. In terms of his mission, there was much that we didn't get to, but the Muslims believe basically Jesus' mission was to come to the Church of Israel, to guide them back to the straight way. Also, his mission was to prophesy about the Prophet Muhammad. There's a whole section that we didn't even get to, where Jesus mentioned in particular that there will be one that will come, and that would be, his name would be Ahmed. This is in the Quran clearly, and we believe this is in the Bible clearly also. We didn't get a chance to cover that, and inshallah, maybe in future events, we have opportunity to delve into those things. But we looked at also ideas about who God is, the qualities of God, the distinction of God, and making the distinction between man and God. And I believe that we show that Jesus failed to meet up to the qualifications of God. In spite of what many may interpret to be him receiving worship or him being called a God, from his own testimony, from his own mouth, refuting and clarifying that he's not God, that he is a man. But when we look at the qualities of God, we see that nothing, not Jesus, not Muhammad, not Abraham, not Moses, not Noah, alayhi muslim, peace be upon all of them, none of them can be equal with God. None of them. They're human beings. And despite their greatness on earth, despite their miracles, despite how they came, how they lived, and how they left, none of them can be equal to God. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Exalted is he. In closing, Pastor Taylor mentioned about the Messiah. He said that if you just believe that Jesus was the Messiah, that's enough for salvation. You don't have to believe that Jesus was God. But according to the scripture, the Messiah that the Jews were expecting would not be killed. It was their belief that the true Messiah could not be killed. So if Jesus was the true Messiah, that means he could not have been killed. And if we believe and accept that Jesus, this is from the biblical scriptures. There's a passage in Hebrews where it says, and the Lord heard his prayer. Jesus prayed, my Father, let this cup pass me by. He didn't want to die. And in Hebrews it says, and his prayer was heard. And in the Old Testament it said that the Messiah will be protected. He would not be harmed. So the true Messiah could not be killed by the people. So if it's a matter of just believing that the Messiah is Jesus, and that's enough for salvation, the Muslims have accomplished that because that's what we believe. But we don't believe he died for our sins, because the Bible teaches something different from that. No man can die for your sins. This is what the Bible. Now you may have other verses that say something different. That's a contradiction that the people of the Bible have to work out. That's not my responsibility. That's not my jurisdiction. This is a Bible discrepancy. The people of the Bible, the scholars, they have to work out these contradictions. It's not the Muslim's responsibility to work these things out. We're just presenting our case. And it's clear from the case that Jesus is a man, Jesus is not God, and also, as prophesied in the Old Testament, the Messiah will not be harmed. So if the Messiah will not be harmed, that means he cannot have been crucified. He cannot have been killed. And this is what the Muslims believe.
I can read it to you right here. This, unfortunately, this is comes to the summary of our program, and I hope that you have some more that we keep in store for the next time.
We like to, when we talk about the word, we like to tell the truth.
No, real fast. Just if you allow, real fast. I'm gonna let respond to that one. I want to just say something real fast. I'm sorry.
Yes, sir.
We want to just break the because it is important to have a rebuttal. And this is a very important topic. He wants to read something, and we will allow that. It's no problem. I just want to say this. I'm not going to say that there may not be verses that's interpreted one way or another. But when we see one thing here and something over here different, that's called a contradiction. And when you have a contradiction, you have to work it out. It's not my responsibility. If it's a contradiction, that means someone's right and someone is wrong. But if it's in the same book, we have a problem. So you can respond to that, you know, and sure. Next time we can respond to the proof that we have also.
I only wanted to respond to the blunt statement that there are no prophecies in the Old Testament that Jesus would die. That's bold-faced. I'm not going to say it's a lie because you're not knowledgeable in the Old Testament like that. But if you read Isaiah 53, he is despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief. We hid our faces from him. He's borne our griefs, carried our sorrows, wounded for our transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, chastened for our peace. With his stripes were healed. And we all like sheep have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity, the sin of us all. He was oppressed, he was afflicted, yet he opened out his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears, he opened out his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment, and who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. This is overwhelmingly supported in the New Testament that he died. At the end of every gospel, he dies. He gives up the ghost. There are several prophecies. Only because you said that it wasn't in the word. If you said that the Quran doesn't teach it, that's one thing.
Yeah, I thought I said in the Bible that it prophesied the Messiah would be protected. That's what I thought I said.
No, you said that he wouldn't die, and that he wouldn't be able to be killed. This is absolutely the contrary to that.
No, I agree, but there are verses also that say the Messiah will be protected, he won't be harmed.
I can show you somebody say he would die. And you show me the one that says he'll be protected. Okay. You gotta show me.
Okay, I did.
I love you, man.
I love you too.
So, alhamdulillah, we will end on that note. Alhamdulillah, that there's love between all of us, inshallah, people of faith. And we want to continue with that spirit. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of you for coming. May He bless those who have the opportunity to hear and be benefited. This is the purpose of these kinds of meetings. Our meetings are to decrease enmity and increase friendship. Decrease enmity and increase friendship. Because we know as Muslims, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said to us in the Quran that the people close to us are Ahlul Kitab, the people of the book. So by that virtue alone, we have an affinity and a friendship that is natural, that is declared, and that this, by virtue of this relationship, we hope to continue along these lines. So we thank again all of you for coming. And we just want to, as a programming note, mention that next Friday, Sheikh Dr. Yasir Qadi is coming to the Allentown Masjid in Lehigh Valley. And this program is entitled Guidelines for Firmly Settling Upon the Truth. And this is, he has two venues that he will appear at. One is the Jummah on the Friday, and at 6 p.m., the evening lecture topic. So we encourage you all to attend that session and to go if you can, inshallah, because we have an affinity with the brothers and sisters in Allentown and Leon Valley. So we remind you again, and we will continue to remind you again, inshallah, on Friday at the Yom Jummah. We want to finally thank Pastor Taylor for his gracious attendance and acceptance of the opportunity to discuss this very vital topic to people of faith. And we wish him Godspeed on his journey back to his venue, his home, and the people that had accompanied him. We want to assure you that there is nothing but friendship from our people who are here. And this is, you know, we never attempt at any outset to defeat you, to humiliate you, to defame you. And I hope that you take away from the kind of company that you have enjoyed here, that sense of brotherhood, friendship, and love.
I really do.
So thank you very much. And we appreciate you. So with that, we can return to the masjid for Salatul Maghrib.
Well, you can show me.